representing four different sectors. One of the crucial questions is, what sector should you work in? What sector is appropriate for your community? And today we'll be talking about energy, banks, land, and employee ownership. These are all great strands of the ownership transition, the new economy transition that we want to, we all are working for. So we have Rich Carpenter. He's the president of Carpenter Associates. Thank you, Rich. He's going to be talking about energy. Rich is with ACORN, Addison County Relocalization Network, also the ACORN Renewable Energy Co-op. So here again, this is about local ownership of energy. Rich is the president of Carpenter Associates. It's a consulting firm. They do strategic planning, business development, and he's been in, assisting early stage companies in software and the internet industry for about 40 years. He's participated in 20 technology startups. I think anybody who would work here ought to have Rich at their table. Sounds like he's a pretty good head to have at the table. We'll be talking more about banks. We have Gwen Hallsmith here. You've already heard from Gwen. She is with the Public Banking Institute, working for a state bank. And she's the founder and executive director of Global Community Initiatives. She has 25 years of experience working with regional and municipal and state government, has a PhD in international environmental policy, and she currently serves as the president of Vermont Earth Institute. Many more accolades, but that gives you a good sense. Paul Millman, we have Paul. And Paul is the founder and president of Chroma Technology. It's an employee-owned company, a really great company, I'll add. And he's also a director of Vermont Business Roundtable and a former director of Vermont Businesses for Social Responsibility. It's one of the oldest social responsibility networks in the country. He's the former board chair of the Vermont Employee Ownership Center, one of the few state centers for employee ownership. So Paul is going to be talking about employee ownership. And then we also have Kathy Ruhf, there we go, yes. She's with Land for Good, talking about issues of land access for farmers. And she's a national leader in questions of farm entry, succession, and tenure. With land, with farmland in particular, it's much more complex than just who owns it. There's all kinds of issues, who has access to the land, how do you have succession for a new generation. And Kathy will be talking about that. She's a co-director of the New England Small Farm Institute and on the USDA Advisory Committee on Beginning Farmers and Ranchers. So, welcome everyone. And why don't we start with Gwen? So tell me, Gwen, why are you working for public banking? Why is that?
Testing.
All right. Got it. There we go.
Thanks. Thanks. Why am I working for public banking? Well, I used to be working for the city of Montpelier. That's what I was doing last year during New Economy Week. But public banking actually asks the really fundamental question of who owns not only Vermont, but who owns the monetary system. Because the money that we use for our economic life, for all our transactions, for our store value, for our unit of account, all of those things are the functions of money you learn about if you've taken an economics class, is actually something that our Constitution guarantees to Congress, and through Congress to the people. It's constitutionally a public right to coin money. The word in French for coining money, seigneurage, actually carries with it that old idea of money issuance being the prerogative of the king, or the prerogative of the government, seigneurage. And it is one of the most powerful forces in our economy. A very famous banker, whose name I don't remember, but just imagine it was J.P. Morgan or Rockefeller, or some of these old bankers from the Gilded Age, said, I care not who is in power in government as long as I have the power to issue the money. And that's actually a fact of our economy that most of us don't recognize, that in 1913, Congress, in its infinite wisdom, in the middle of the night on December 23rd, when almost nobody was there, passed a law called the Federal Reserve Act that effectively delegated this right of coining money to the private banking system. It was something that leaders in our country had been opposed to, famously, for many, many years. Andrew Jackson was one of the famous opponents of this sort of centralized private banking system, as was Lincoln and many others, who coincidentally also had attempts on their life, because it's a fairly famous and powerful lobby, the banking lobby, that controls our monetary system. So the public banking movement really does work in direct contrast to that, where it tries to put the power of issuing the money that we use to run our economy back in public hands. And this accomplishes a few objectives. One of the most important of which, to me, as a lifelong environmentalist, is that it tends to act as a braking system on the growth imperative that is driven by the positive interest money in circulation. That's one of the things my research has shown me to be true, that the fact that all of the money that we use comes into existence through the issuance of debt, through the banking sector, means that all of that money carries with it this expectation that it has to earn profit. And that expectation that the money needs to produce a return in turn drives companies to need to make profits at increasing rates. It drives our expectations around growth and is driving us all into the ground. The other thing that it accomplishes, of course, is by putting the returns on the lending that is done for housing, students, economic development and infrastructure back in the public sector for public purposes. So it can serve as a revenue stream in cities, states, and counties that are using public banking that goes beyond taxes and goes beyond cutting programs, which is what we always hear when we're short of revenues. In North Dakota, the public bank there has transferred over $300 million into the state's coffers over the last 10 years. And they have no bigger population than Vermont. Now imagine what we would do here in Vermont if we had an extra $300 million. Well, we might be able to fund the single payer system that we hear so much about. We might be able to clean up Lake Champlain. Some of these things that we've been told there's just not enough money to do. And so both of those purposes, the revenue stream for public purposes and the breaking effect that it has on the growth imperative, I think are two really important systemic reasons to support public banking.
That's perfect, Gwen. Thank you. That's really great. So Paul, let me ask you the same question. You run a company, and why did you decide to make it employee-owned?
I feel like I've been talking about employee ownership for my whole life. So it gets a little bit strange when I wonder who knows, who's already heard the spiel, who hasn't heard the spiel. We started Chrome in 1991. There were six of us, and we had a huge fight about who should own it. There were seven of us initially, and one person came to the rest of us and said his family and his family's friends would be very happy to fund the company in return for equity. And that presented the possibility that the rest of us would have to produce equity in order to be part of the ownership team. And it was clear from the other six that perhaps three could invest, but it also meant that three couldn't invest. And that meant that the three who couldn't invest would work for the three and the four and the fourth who could invest. And the concept that those who were starting the company would work for some of the people who started the company was repugnant to me. I also, for those of you who looked at our website and looked at our news reports and looked at the interview that was done with me in the Vermont Business Magazine some years ago, I have to admit, I come from a socialist family. So the concept of employee ownership was sort of in the genes. But it's in the genes because people who do the work should benefit from their work. There's a place for equity. There's a place for people who invest in helping start companies. But that place has to be limited. It can't go on forever. They need to get their rewards, and in our case, we did. So we borrowed what now seems like a relatively small amount of money, but seemed like an awfully big amount of money at the time, approximately $230,000 from family and friends, and some of us who had some extra money invested also, and we paid what seemed to be an exorbitant interest rate at the time of 12.5% to those people, and after 5 years, they got their return on their investment and we got our company. So I think there's a place for equity, but it has to have limits. And then the people who do the work get to own the company. That itself has some problems, and maybe we can get into that later. I wanted to comment just briefly on New Orleans,
okay,
because it is relevant to this discussion. What year was Katrina?
2005.
Okay, so in 2006, I went to New Orleans for a meeting of a scientific society. So Chroma is a company that supplies optical filters to the biotech industry primarily. And there was a meeting in New Orleans of the American Society of Human Genetics, and we exhibit at those meetings. And so it was a year after the hurricane, and I wandered around town, and I saw it beginning to be rebuilt. And I noticed that it was not beginning to be rebuilt by people who were from New Orleans. As it happens, there was a meeting of the United States Federation of Worker-Owned Cooperatives in New York City the weekend that I was coming back from that meeting. So I went directly from New Orleans to New York City to this meeting, and the night before the meeting there was a dinner at what was then a fabulous co-op restaurant in Manhattan, which was a high-end French restaurant of all things. And so there were many people from the cooperative and employee-owned community at this dinner, and the discussion was about New Orleans. And the discussion was about what will the government do, and what will the government do, and what will the government do? And here we were with skills unfathomable in business and in construction and in how to rebuild communities. And nobody was talking about doing that. And it was one of the saddest moments of my life. There were people who were ready to go to New Orleans and help organize cooperatives of builders and train people how to rebuild the community. And nobody was talking about it.
That's great. Thank you for that great story. Yeah, so sometimes there's a very powerful role for government. Sometimes we just need to roll up our sleeves and get together and do things ourselves. So I think that there's many pathways into how we look. Well, do you have a microphone over there? Should we use this one?
Oh, okay.
Let's try this one. So this is great. It's lovely to get different issues out on the table. And yeah, so Rich, so I'll let you hold that. I have no lavalier, so I'll be okay. Thank you. Yeah, so tell me, why are you doing the work that you're doing? And tell us, why do you think it matters?
Well, first I have two hats on. Sometimes folks who have heard of ACORN are a little bit confused. There's an ACORN network and an ACORN Renewable Energy Co-op. I happen to be on the boards of both, and they're sister organizations that came from a common parent. But the ACORN network focuses on local food, farm to school, farm to plate, and also co-sponsors with the Addison County Economic Development Corporation, something that could be very relevant in our discussion today, a one-day workshop called Financing the Working Landscape, which will be on November 6th in Middlebury. It's available on the ACORN Network website. What I'd like to touch on a bit today is the ACORN Renewable Energy Co-op, and particularly some of the things that Marjorie said and Paul's comments. There was a committee of the original Addison County Relocation Network that met over a couple of years from 2006 to 2008, focused on energy and a belief that renewable energy was a really key part of the new economy in the future, and a bit frustrated by how little we were seeing happening in Addison County. And after a couple years of thinking about different options and alternatives, we decided to form a member-owned cooperative incorporated in Vermont and focused initially on wood pellets produced by a Vermont-based company in North Clarendon, and to promote and distribute those to our members. That led to solar hot water installations on residences, solar PV, and we kept running into people who said, gee, I'd really like to do solar, but my house faces, you know, three huge trees that I don't want to cut down. One reason or another that they couldn't do residential solar, which led us to the idea of community solar. And about 3 years ago, we did our first community solar project, which was a 150 kilowatt array. For those who may not know how big that is, it's about 600 individual panels and spread on racks that face due south, hopefully with an unobstructed view to the sun, and occupy about an acre of land. And we were able to do a project collaboratively with all local institutions in one way or another. Cooperative Insurance, which is itself a cooperative based in Middlebury. The National Bank of Middlebury provided some of the loan funding. And Vermont Economic Development Authority, VEDA, provided some of the loan funding. And we were able to set it up in such a way that 16 of our members, by paying a membership fee, could get essentially 2% of the output of the electricity from the array to offset their electrical meters. And we were able to structure that in such a way that it was actually a decent investment for people. They put up $2,000 up front. They received interest on that, very low interest, 2%, but was better than most people were seeing in any bank accounts or mutual money market funds. And the net internal rate of return of that investment, which, by the way, the loan would be paid back after we had serviced all of the debt for the array, was about 7%, which seemed very attractive to people. That led us to say, gee, how can we do our next array in such a way that many people in the community can participate? This is an investment of about $700,000, so it's not huge by, you know, billion-dollar standards, but it's also not, you know, walking around money for most people. And we certainly wanted to have an offering where many, many people could invest in the equity of the of the next array. But we were really stymied by the securities laws, which really prevent offering securities based on laws enacted by the Congress in 1934, quite a while ago, to so-called accredited investors who have a net worth of in excess of $1 million or more than $200,000 in annual income. So we were very encouraged 2.5 years ago by Congress passing something called the Jobs Bill. You may be familiar with it. It's Jumpstart Our Business Startups. and it had a very exciting aspect to it, which was that for the first time it would be possible to sell securities across state lines, even using the internet. And all that had to happen was for the SEC to write regulations. Well, the regulations were finally written about a year ago, put out for review. The comment period ended in February, and we're still waiting to see what type of regulations come out. But the idea is that organizations will be able to, such as ours, to raise up to $1 million. Individuals can invest up to 5% of their annual income, capped by $5,000, if they make $100,000 or less a year, and up to 10% if they make more than $100,000. So we've been kind of waiting on the sidelines, thinking that that was imminent. We're told that the regulations will happen or come out by the end of December, which is only 2.5 months away, so fingers are crossed. In the meantime, the state of Vermont legislature has done two very important steps this late spring. One in June, called the Vermont Small Business Offering Exemption, which enables companies, it's patterned in many ways after the federal law, that it allows Vermont companies to raise up to $1 million, sell shares to residents of Vermont, can't go across state lines because that would violate the SEC regulations. And there are a number of limitations. It's up to $10,000 per individual per year. But that looks to us to have many of the characteristics that the federal jobs law would have. Another, which I won't talk about in great detail, is something called the Sun Exemption, which is specifically for community solar projects. And to get back to Marjorie's question, our goal at the end of the day is to have solar arrays that are owned by local residents, operated by local residents, and benefit in long-term local residents. And we feel that renewable energy is the way of the future. We're moving slowly in that direction. I didn't say anything about this before, but over the past year, we've worked collaboratively with Encore Redevelopment here in, or not here, but in Burlington, who have the engineering skills and financing skills to put solar arrays into place, and we've collaborated with them to help identify sites and also off-takers, people who use the electricity. And there's roughly a megawatt, in other words, 650 kilowatt arrays that should be producing electricity before the end of the year. So we haven't been quiet, but the holy grail is to find ways that local Vermonters can invest in solar arrays that will provide electricity to offset their use of electricity produced by any other means.
That's great. Thank you so much, Rich. Yeah, I mean, one of the questions we face as a society is, are we going to continue with concentrated energy production, or can we have distributed energy? More resilient, more sustainable, and shouldn't we have distributed ownership as well? So that's great work. Good. Well, let's hear from Kathy. So talk to us a little bit about what you're doing with land tenure, and tell us about why that work is important.
Okay, thanks. I'm very glad to be here, and I notice, unlike my esteemed colleagues, I need a little bit of notes. I've been working on farmland access and beginning farmer issues for almost 30 years now, and what's thrilling to me is that I'm always learning something. So I want to talk a little bit today about what my organization does, but also some of the questions that keep coming up for me as I continue to learn. So our specialty is farmland access, tenure, and transfer, all the way that farmers get onto, hold, and pass on farms and farmland. Our mission is to get more farmers more securely on more land in New England and nationally as well. Mike Gia, who's sitting in the back of the room, is our Vermont field agent. We have folks on the ground that work directly with farmers. And we also do some research and policy work, again, continuing to explore innovative responses to the question that we're talking about today for the agriculture sector. And I want to start with a quote that I found about 15 years ago that has really continued to guide me. It's by Liberty Hyde Bailey, whom some of you may know as the father of modern horticulture. He wrote this in 1909. Equitable partition of land is the necessary basis of all self-sustaining agriculture. This partition and use of land may be in the form of ownership or in the form of the right to hold the land for a specific time. So what brings me my interest to this dialogue is that the farmland tenure issue not only is a particular twist on the ownership conundrum, but also, I think, for me, and I hope for some of you as well, helps to enrich the exploration of this really important issue. Tenure comes out of a Latin word, which means to hold, and so we're really talking about the ways that farmers hold land. Now, farms in Vermont are made up of the farm businesses and also the land, and that's not necessarily the same owners or the same thing. And farmers also have to live for mostly where they farm. So it's also, you know, there's this multi-layered aspect to the farmland question. So to me, when I thought about this, who owns Vermont, the questions came up for me, who does own Vermont? And Marta found a couple of quotes, statistics, which I'm going to add to. And then who should or should not own the farmland in Vermont? Vermont has about 7,300 farms that cover about 1.2 million acres, according to the 2012 census. And about 60% of those have gross annual sales of less than $10,000. They're very small farms and typically part-time. So in terms of how these farms contribute to the economy and their relationship to the land and farm businesses, you know, we have to sort of think about that as a very rich tapestry. Okay, it's not simply that farmers should, that farmers own or should own their land. Only two-thirds of farmers own all of the land that they farm, as you pointed out in your piece of data. So that's a third that rent some or all of the land that they farm. That's slightly less than the national average, where about less than half own all of their land. So this notion of tenure being equivalent to ownership is really belies the fact that farmers don't own all the land that they farm. And there's really a culture of, especially private property, land ownership in general, and particularly among the farming community. There's something about you're not a real farmer if you don't own your land. And we work with many farmers who come in as startup farmers who believe that that's the only way that they can really achieve their farming goals. Truth is, the last time this study was done, less than 3% of U.S. farmland was owned by people under the age of 35. So that ownership is falling increasingly into the hands of older farmers. There's also a study that I feel is really important to this discussion, which is that beginning farmers are less likely to fail, or they're more likely to succeed if they don't carry land debt. So we have this sort of mixed message that in reality farmers don't own or have to own the land that they farm. On the other hand, the government within USDA provides a sort of seductive loan, subsidized loan programs for beginning farmers to buy land. So we have this sort of mixed message, and we also don't have an overarching federal national policy about farmland tenure and access. This is really a dialogue that is only recently becoming more important on the radar screen of communities as well as the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Several studies of beginning farmers show that they identify access to land as their biggest challenge, access to land and capital, and primarily that capital is for land as well. So, complication with farmland, to me, is that farmland is a means of production. It's also an appreciating asset. It also has deep resonance for the farm families who have been on those farms for three generations or some other kind of a piece of real estate. So it's deeply emotive. That's a layer that has to be considered when we're talking about this issue of ownership. So the challenges, especially for new and beginning farmers, are the available supply of land, and that's diminishing, especially in more developed areas as land is converted to non-farming uses. So their adequate land has to be available. It has to be appropriate. It has to be the right kind of land to farm. It has to be suited for that right kind of enterprise. It has to be accessible by public transportation and so on, or public roads, I should say. It has to be affordable, and that isn't the same as cheap land. We forget that if a farmer is making a very profitable business, he or she can afford to buy land. So the question is how to make the land affordable for somebody to get onto it. It also has to have the appropriate security. Ultimate security is from ownership, but you can have secure tenure without having to own it. So we need to look at this notion of security as well. And one of the biggest challenges for farmers in our region, as well as nationally, is it has to be findable. There's no easy way to find, locate, and make these deals to get onto land. There isn't any MLS or Zillow for farmland, and we've been working on that issue because there are landowners, and I'm really interested, Rich, in learning, hearing what you say about that new jobs provision. Yeah. Because there are people who want to make their land available, there are people who want to help farmers get onto land, and it's really hard to match them up with the farmers who are looking for land. So for me, the questions are, should farmers own their land, which farmers, and under what conditions? And this begs for me the question, this is not only about ownership, but it's about usership, and it's about relationship in this particular context. And those are the kinds of things that tenure bring up for me as well. So if farmers don't own the land, who does own the land, and does it matter? What's the relationship between the owner and the user, and how does the treatment of the land and land stewardship fit into that dynamic? What are the rights conferred to those parties, the owner and the user, and what's the impact? And where do the benefits accrue? This is, again, one of the key questions around land tenure, as well as any of these other business ownership models that we're talking about. One of the biggest challenges is that Vermont and New England and nationally, farmer populations are aging, and so as more farmers exit, we need to pay particular attention to how those farms, farm businesses, and farmland will transition to the next generation or owner. More farmers who are entering farming are coming from non-farming backgrounds. They don't inherit a farm. They don't get gifted a farm. So it's not that they have additional challenges to get onto farms. And exiting farmers who don't typically plan in a timely fashion for farm succession wind up being stuck by facing a retirement crisis, not having done estate planning, and winding up making less than timely decisions about what happens to that farm. So it's not just a question of farm entry. It's working with established and exiting farmers as well to complete that cycle. Is that good enough for starters?
That's a great start. That's very good. Yeah, I think it's lovely that we came to you fourth, Kat, because I think that you, what you point to is the fact that ownership is not a single thing. I mean, we tend to speak as though ownership is a fact, either you own something or you don't. But in fact, every first year law student learns that ownership is a bundle of twigs. It's a bundle of rights, and they can be separated out and distributed in various ways. You can have an easement that guarantees the right of access, for example. There's an easement on the land in front of my house. My neighbors have easement that they have the right to walk on it, so they have the right of access. Kathy's talking about the right of use, and can there be some security for farmland, for farmers? Yes, that can be created separate from ownership. There's the right to extract wealth. This is something that we heard from Paul about. I mean, who has the right to for the profits of a company? And then there's the issue of control. And who controls the enterprise? Who controls the access to the land? And this is something that Gwen talked about. Who controls the right to issue money? So really we're talking about economic power. We don't have good language for it. Ownership, I use the word ownership because it's kind of a good umbrella term. But really we're talking about cultural customs around economic power. And they tend to get bundled together and attached to different pieces of assets. So we put a lot of things on the table here. This is a very, very rich panel. We want to, let me just sort of catch us up on where we are in the morning. We want to get into some breakout sessions starting at around 10:30. And so I'm going to do two things here. I want the panel to be thinking. I'm going to come back to you in about 10 minutes, and I'm going to ask you, what's your vision of the future? How would you like things to unfold? What's the challenge you'd like to issue for this room? And I'm going to want you to each do that in about 1 minute. So think about how you want to do that. Meanwhile, so that's what your closing remarks. What do you want to say to the people here? And meanwhile, I want to open it up to the group and let's get some questions and answers and see what are people thinking, what kind of questions you have.
Jeremy Ingpen. I wanted to start with a public service announcement. I brought along a report called Community Industry in Vermont, Addressing Worker Ownership, Cooperative Management, Capital Formation, and Community Industry, 1975. There's a pile up front, and I'd be very disappointed if any were left at the end of the day. What I would like is that if you feel you can make a donation, which would go to the Ryan Fried Sustainability Center at Sterling College. Ryan Fried was one of the founders, or the primary founder of Clean Yield, and the Sustainability Center is training young farmers in Vermont and around the world in new techniques. So I would be very disappointed if any copies were left, and it would be great if we could put a little bit of money towards the Ryan Fried Sustainability Center. The ribbon cutting was just last month. The comment I have as we look at this whole sector is, and we're trying to make the whole economy go rapidly in reverse from everything we've seen in the last 40 years, but one other thing that's happened in the last 40 years is massive new mechanisms for capital formation, and businesses stall when they run out of capital. And if you want to summarize what happened between 75 and 2015, it's new capital mechanisms and businesses going public and then going private and then going public again to release money and massive wealth formation. And as we look at these new mechanisms, whether it's banking or farming or new businesses, what is the new paradigm, if there is one, for capital formation, if we're not just to start the whole cycle off again?
Yeah, what is the new paradigm for capital formation? Who would like to tackle that, Gwen?
Does this work?
Oh, let's get this mic
for the video. It's best to use that one.
Okay.
I think the new paradigm of capital formation needs to mirror the new paradigm of capital. We've learned in the last 10 years that capital is not just financial capital, but it's natural capital, it's human capital, it's social capital, it's technological capital, it's innovation and entrepreneurial capital. So we need to think holistically about how capital forms. And looking as carefully as I have at the monetary system, I can say that financial capital has been excellent in forming large concentrations of itself through this positive interest monetary system that we have that acts like a giant sucking sound upward, extracting wealth from the poorest among us and transferring it to the richest among us. But we also need to understand how alternative means of exchange and alternative stores of value could serve that same function for natural capital, human capital, social capital, and other forms of wealth that we need as a human family. So for example, time banking, which is an excellent way to create a means of exchange in a community using time instead of money, is a great way to form human and social capital. Commercial barter systems, like the beer system in Switzerland, is an excellent way to form entrepreneurial capital and business capital because of the way that money is circulated among businesses to help them stay going even in times of financial problems. And natural capital systems that are emerging, like the carbon taxing and the water credit trading that's emerging in developing areas for water conservation and carbon reduction are also excellent ways to support and form the natural capital that we need to maintain our communities and our societies. So I think we really need to look hard at how we make exchanges in these areas of capital and how those forms accumulate through those exchanges in much the same way that financial capital has been doing for us in the monetary sphere for a long time.
Great, thank you. Yes,
Did that answer your question?
I think it's a start. It's a very complex question. It's a very good one. We can probably talk all day on that.
Yeah, hi. I'm here on bended knee from Western Massachusetts to learn from Vermont, and I appreciate your vision and all of your projects. The thing that's in the back of my head right now is, I suppose, a challenge because I recognize the creativity behind the projects and the options that we have, but I keep thinking, how do we integrate that with a larger system that is extractive? And I'm thinking of Ben & Jerry's and Odwalla and Stonyfield and these companies that have had to sell out to the larger institutions, and how do we keep the localization in place when that seems to be as much of a trend as what we're trying to do?
Paul, do you want to talk about that?
The phrase "have to have sold out" is the operative phrase. They didn't have to sell out. Okay, so there are pressures. You may remember when Ben & Jerry's went public, the reason for going public was they needed the money to, for lack of a better term, buy shelf space. The grocery business is a real estate business. You have to have real estate. You have to have a place for your product. The furniture business is the same. You buy footage if you're a wholesaler in a furniture store. So there are some realities of life that that force you into some positions. There's a small dairy in Walpole, New Hampshire, makes incredibly wonderful ice cream. They're never going to be big because it's not their desire. So I am not being critical of companies who wish to be big and wish to have the kind of presence that potential partners like Danone provided for Stonyfield, or Unilever provided for Ben & Jerry's. If that's what you want, that's perfectly reasonable. There are other things that you can do that are socially responsible and socially progressive with your money. But you've made a decision, so it's not like you're forced into that position. There are market forces that force people into all sorts of positions that may or may not be comfortable for them. At some point, our company is facing the prospect of competing with very much larger, deep-pocketed companies. What do we do in that situation? We like to think that we're so good that we can do it without external partners. I don't know that that's true. So the first thing that I would argue is that if you're employee-owned, you have an anchor in the community. You have a very real reason to be in the community because you live in that community. And our company would argue, and not all employee-owned companies argue this, our company would argue that you might want to try a slightly inverted salary scale, so that people whose, for lack of a better term again, whose jobs are less skilled than some other positions are paid higher than market wages. And people who are in higher skilled positions might be paid somewhat lower or at market. The problem there is it then becomes, once you get a more sophisticated kind of enterprise, it becomes difficult to compete for labor. So you're constantly looking for people who both have skills and also agree with how you see life. And so far we've been very lucky that way. But recently we lost two engineers, not because they disagreed with how we do things, but because rural parts of Vermont, the non-Chittenden County parts of Vermont, are more difficult to attract people to, especially if they're two professional families, and we hire one, what's the other one going to do? So a lot of the answer to your question is a consciousness. Marjorie talked about South Mountain before. They made a conscious decision to limit the work that they're doing. And I love them, and they're very fortunate because they do incredibly high quality work. So they can choose the buildings that they want to build. They can choose the people that they want to work for. That's not necessarily true of a factory like ours, where we're constantly looking for the new customers because we don't know whether the old customers are going to stay with us, whether their businesses are going to survive. So for us, you don't have the luxury of that kind of growth. But I believe, and I don't know any other way of doing this, I believe you must have some kind of political, social consciousness to what you do in order to survive and not be tempted by the temptations of the world. We had, just very briefly, one of our competitor companies was sold a few years ago for $60 million. We are bigger than they are. So the assumption is that we're worth more than they are. And that's incredibly tempting, so I understand when companies, Toms of Maine, found
an object whose sole purpose is maximum extraction of wealth in terms of living community. Yes, it does have aspects of being an object, so it's a complex change. Let's take a couple more questions here. We have another question, thought?
Hi, Erin O'Connell here. I actually work in the healthcare industry, and my company was recently acquired by a company out in California. So I'm just a regular schmuck here, okay? My question regards measurement, because time is a measurement, and money is a measurement for us. So speaking of a new consciousness and a new paradigm, I was curious to hear about gift economies, something immeasurable. And if anybody has any input on that, that would be appreciated. Thanks.
Gift economy. Question about gift economies is something immeasurable.
Which question? When the raise your hand.
Okay, Gwen, you want to address that one? Come back around here.
And measurement is a really important aspect of the new economy that I think needs a lot of attention, actually, because there is a school of thought that says we get what we measure. You know, if we're measuring it in money, we're going to get that kind of monetary measurement. If we use time as the unit of exchange, as the unit of measure, then we're going to achieve more in that realm. The gift economy is a really interesting aspect of looking at monetary systems because it negates all of them. It says, wait a minute, maybe there's something more human than this mathematical computation of value that the monetary mindset imposes on all of us. And I think that the experiments in the gift economy around the country, and there are many of them, where people have banded together to really try to make exchanges with each other based on human relations rather than the values in the system that are assigned to those things, are illuminating an element of our past and potentially our future that are really important to see. It's hard to imagine how one would trade petroleum products in the gift economy, or the things that are actually scarce on the planet. That is part of the reason the monetary system works so well for some of the things that are scarce, because it values only those things that are scarce. So the gold in your ring, the pitching arm of the Red Sox pitcher, the oil that we use to run our economy, let's not ignore that fact, all are scarce and are mediated by an artificially scarce monetary system. But things that we need and have in abundance, care for our children, care for our elders, our artistic and creative qualities, our participation in our destinies through our democratic actions, all of those things we need in abundance, and they are systematically shortchanged by money exchanges and by the type of very careful, precise, calculating measurement that those exchanges foster. So I'd just like to applaud you for bringing it up. It's a hard system to superimpose on the other system, but the fact that it exists, the fact that it existed before what we have now, and that it's likely to be an important character and capacity of the future is worth talking about.
That's great. Thank you. Okay. I want to come back to our panelists now. I want you to each take 1 minute, try to keep it short. Let's just hear what's your vision of the future? Where would you like this to be going? And do you have a challenge you'd like to address the audience today? Let's just run down the line here, for each of you.
In a minute. I think the whole notion of farmland tenure really needs to be a dialogue at every level of community, and land has to be made more available and accessible to beginning and also established farmers through more creative and equitable paths to ownership. It doesn't have to be immediate ownership, but the holding out for the promise of a person owning a farm still needs to be out there. We need to have more secure alternatives to ownership, better leases, better relationships between landlords and tenants, longer term leases, ground leases, which Marjorie mentioned briefly, wherein a farmer rents the ground but owns the improvements on them and is able to build equity there. We need more creative shared ownership models. That's why this suggestion about the jobs, the non-accredited investors has come up a lot. We did a quick research project on the role of farmland investors, and it's something we're continuing to explore. I know it's a hot issue here as well as elsewhere, and I would just say that there's not enough information to say what of those farmland investor models can really work. They're not all black hat, they're not all white hat. They're still evolving, and it really remains to be seen what's in it for the farmer as well as for the investor. But if you see an investor as a partner who is helping a farmer to acquire some kind of secure tenure, I think that there are models there that are possible. Just thinking outside the box a little, and then I'll close it up. Paul, I was struck when you talked about the more remote areas in terms of land affordability. We also have to think about what the food system looks like, and Vermont has done an enormous amount of work on food systems and this notion of what constitutes a supply chain and how farmers who might actually be able to afford to produce in a more remote area of the countryside can actually get product to market. If regional supply chains were made more robust, if they were able to aggregate their product, they could in fact establish more affordable farms in more remote areas. So just an example of not everybody has to farm in Burlington to get started. I would say also finally, really bringing in the folks who have available or capable farmland into partnership. And those can be resident or absentee landowners. The challenge there is that as landlords become farther removed from the land, they're less likely to make really good agreements with farmers. So engaging the community, including landowners who have farmland, would be part of the challenge. Thanks.
That's great. Thank you.
As I look to the future, it seems to me that hopefully 10 or 15 years from now, we might look back at 2014 as being a real perfect storm of possibilities, and I mean specifically for the broad distribution of ownership of new enterprises among Vermonters and perhaps the rest of the country. We've all seen the success of websites like Indiegogo and Kickstarter to raise money for projects where the idea is you donate money and then you get some type of token gift back in return. If you carry that concept to enabling people to invest in new enterprises, relatively small investments, where the power of social media, the power of communications and the internet, and frankly, the enabling legislation, first here in Vermont and hopefully eventually with the SEC, to make it possible for people with ideas or with small businesses to acquire the capital that they need in order to grow. The thing that I think could really enable that is perhaps a nonprofit organization, perhaps a government organization, who knows, but that could provide both the platform on the internet and the templates, if you will, to help people with ideas to translate those into appropriate types of offering documents and to provide guidance and coaching along the way to make use of this new mechanism. I think it will be very, very successful, and I think the internet with social media will guard against the potential scams that could happen, because we will hear very quickly of bad actors that are trying to promote really, really poor potential investments. So I think there's a new possibility here that in my business lifetime has not been available, and that's to go out publicly and get small investments from large numbers of people.
Great. Very nice. Thank you. All right. Well, Paul, hear about your vision, maybe a challenge for the room.
I don't know if it's a vision or a wish. When I imagine the future, I imagine a world in which just because you work means you're able to have a comfortable and secure existence without killing the planet on which we live. I don't know that I see that happening, but I can imagine that happening.
Thanks. Well, money is power. We all accept that paradigm. But if we think about power as energy and money as energy and think about all we're doing to decentralize and distribute our energy generation, and try to imagine that same type of phenomenon happening with the ways we make exchanges with each other and store value and keep our accounts in the monetary system through public banking as one element. Imagine for a minute that instead of borrowing money to build schools, hospitals, roads, sidewalks, bus facilities, and run our public transit systems and our job creation systems and to send our young people to college, local governments and state governments and regional governments could issue the money into existence because of the fact that they are empowered to do that. We're all stuck in this box of privately owned money and the fact that the public sector always needs to be borrowing it to use it. That isn't necessarily the truth. Money, in addition to being power and energy, is also fundamentally an agreement. An agreement that we all have to use something as our means of exchange, as our means of running our economy. And like all agreements, it can change. And I think today's era of dramatically increased inequality, where increasingly a very tiny percentage of our population controls the media, controls the wealth, controls what happens in our economy, it's time for that agreement to change. And a very practical step toward making it change is by working at the local, regional, and state levels to create public banks. The city of Santa Fe right now is exploring a feasibility study and an economic impact analysis of creating a bank at the city level. Here in Vermont, we have the capacity, we have the capital, we have the means to create a public bank at the state level. There's counties in California and Pennsylvania that are looking at creating county banks. But we need to have the wherewithal to do it is just another public interest announcement. I got a kick out of the fact that Marjorie said this is a rich panel because public banking institutes are actually a pretty poor nonprofit organization and we need support. You know, last year at this time, I ended up on unemployment by the end of the year because of my advocacy for public banking. And this year, we might end up on unemployment again at the Public Banking Institute if we don't raise the money we need to continue to pay the staff that we have to help these entities, these public entities, create public banks for the public good. So thanks.
Great. Well, this has been a great panel. I want you to join me in giving them a nice round of applause.